talking to Noel Clarke, who would have been the first sacristan in Ballyfermot, and was here for the first Mass in 1953. Noel, your earliest memories of growing up in, where you came from originally?
I was born in Campbell Street. I lived there for 3 years before I moved to a street called St. Gallus, which was Carsley. And that was a two-room house. When we moved from there to Ballyfermot, it was 8 years living there. I'd be living in the two-room house. So when we got to Ballyfermot, it was a bit of a mansion. Got a house on Valley Road. It was like a kitchen house, as seen from the parlour house. Because I had 3 bedrooms. I had 2 sisters and 4 brothers and a father, so the 3 bedrooms were necessary. Although we had survived for all the years in the two-room house. Bit of a I have one survive in such condition, but whatever happens when you grow up. But I know when we arrived in 158 Laddie Road, there was no gas, there was no electricity, there was no public reason. And the whole area had just been dead. But to us, it was a great adventure that we had a house with a bath in it. The only bad way to know was the bath in front of the fire on the Saturday night. It was a question of who gets battered first, or second, or fourth, and the water wasn't changed, or whatever. That was beside him. But Ballyfermot was a revelation, because all of a sudden, coming from the inner city to this open fields, it was like a huge big playground, a bit like the Phoenix Park. And we exploited it as a format, as well as the open fields, so as the houses were being built. And we were out there, we were in around them, playing cowboys, Indians, whatever. Like, I was 14 at that time, so I was still full of the joys of youth. It was a couple of, I know, with no electricity and no gas, it was imperative that there was a fire for the cook. And the fuel, I think we used to have to travel down to Inchy Cove to get fuel for the fire. There was little or no coal at the time. It was tough or rickets or wet logs. And the tough depot was, I can't remember where it was at that time. I know one came to Ballyfermot just about years later. But it was light the fire and they're getting ready for the dark coming in. He walked into the SP. So it was always important to have the dinner on the table for the dad. I had left school at that time. And I had gone to St. Kevin's School in Black Pits. So 14 was the greatest day of my life to get out of it. Because I was not a keen student. And in Ballyfermot, it was just an open area. And I met some of the lads who lived in our area. They moved to Ballyfermot also. And we were spent most of the day playing football. And we thought it was great. Not necessarily kickball. And one day that I said, when are you going to go for a job? I kind of came as a shock to the system that I'd come up for a job. He said, as of tomorrow, you get yourself moving and look for a job. At that time there was no bus service. And it meant that if you wanted a bus in the town, you'd walk to Inchy Cove to get a bus. But only getting a bus would have needed money for the bus. And we didn't have money for buses. So each morning I'd have to get up. And my dad made sure before he left for work that he was out of the bed and go see that he walked up for jobs. And I would walk up and down to Thomas Street, James Street, High Street, all around that area, in the other places, asking any apartments, any vacancies. We always give them that. No. I remember on one instance I went into a place. I said, yeah, we're looking for a young man. And they asked me a few questions, school, to do with the primary idea, to got the primary. And they asked me, religion? I said, Catholic. I know, can't apply that. So it was my first. Just made rise at the time, the first introduction to the void that I may have existence on jobs. When I was on the way home on the day, I had no brown, just 40 steps. And there was a place there called the Chimbo Toy Company. So again, I asked them if they had any vacancies. They said, yeah, we're looking for young ones to walk here. Start on Monday. So I started at the Chimbo Toy Company on Monday. Fortunately, at that time, a single deck of us had been out of the service in Ballyfermot. And I went from O'Hogan Road into town. And went via the John's Road. So it was handy for me getting off on John's Road, come up what was, we would have called the private road, the military road, into the Royal Hospital, up the 40 steps. I was there and walked before. And then that was a short place of time. But I always stayed in the job for, I think, 3 or 4 weeks. Because the job entailed moulds, lead being cast into in moulds, all sorts of shapes. Soldiers, holy water pans, iron maker boots. And I think in all the mould, they had been paired off hospitals and excess of lead on them. But they didn't have any protective clothing. They had a jug of medicines in their bare hand, and I forgot, could get a rag. So he ended up with blisters and bones and all sorts. So I lasted about 3 weeks. I'd taken a wage at the time, somewhere around 10 shillings. So I was early job then, and then one evening a man of mine sent up board directly down to the Hamelin Medical Company on City Keane. And I duly presented myself down there. Sent up my aunt and sent me down to see Mr. Gregson. Oh, he says, you know, I heard you were coming. We're looking for a nipper. And it was a scrapyard. So I started to walk in the Hamelin Medical Company as a nipper. And there was about 50 men there. My job in that was making the tea for them at 10 o'clock in the morning or 1 o'clock. Also going over cigarettes for them. Now at that time that was 1949, late 49. And cigarettes were scarce. And I'd have to go parading around Pierce Street, Western Road, getting a few cigarettes in each shop to facilitate getting the walkers. I know the names of cigarettes were ingrained in my head from it was the Cold Lake players. There was players' mates, Kerry Blue, Drumhead, Sweet Afton, Craven A, and God knows what other ones. I never kind of wanted this particular brand, which wasn't always easy to facilitate them. But however, I survived that, and after a year, I was promoted onto a machine, and I was on the machine then working. It was 4 years working on that, and I got involved in the wife's club in Ballyfermot. And
yeah, unfortunately, though, when you employed as a sergeant before you actually got involved in that, in Bally, you know, you were employed.
No, I know my father, he was a collector in the church on O'Hogan Road. And he came down on Saturday morning and he said to me, if you're so smart kicking football, Father Boland wants to start the boys' club. And to me, up in the upper, up by the front window in the church. So I'll be up there on Saturday. So I presented myself up on the Saturday. There was a group of other lads there. And Father Bob was asked for our names. Well, I told him I was Noel Clarke. I said, are you a relation of Paddy Clarke? Yeah, I said, he did that. Okay, he said, you mind the footballs? He gave me 4 footballs to mine. He said, we want to get a boys' club started. Oh, he said, there'll be a meeting on, I think it was the following week or the week after, over in the presbytery. And you come along. Now, in the meantime, I was the custodian of the footballs. And it was the first time I'd ever had a new football. And the lads I know were telling me a long way. Most of them come from where I was amazed at the crowds that was there. I used to pick maybe 10 aside, 12 aside. I didn't matter what it was. But I know on the day that I went to the meeting with the they're not going to meet much after the so I had a clue what it was all about. And there was men much more my senior there. And Father Boland was the chairman. And there was a couple of meetings and they said we formed a committee. And I can still remember the names of some committee. Not all of them. That's what I might know. I know there was a Jim Palmer, there was a George Jago, Stephen Kennedy, Eddie Phipps, Sean Brennan, Gerry Farnan, and there was Mr. Donnelly, and I scribbled down there.
As you know, most their families are still, some of them are still living in Ballyfermot. They love to hear this.
You've got Sean Ryan, Jerry Farr, and myself, and Mr. Donnelly. And they were the people who come up with the committee. And at one of the meetings, Father Boland, I said, look, we'll have to get him. It's not enough to just kick the ball around. And not going anywhere, we have to join a league. So he said, there was a Khaki King Council League, the CYC League, and he said, they have an offices down on Marion Square. So at that meeting, I was detailed to go down and enroll the team in the league. Now, if we could just go back a bit, and we're doing the kickabouts now, the goalposts, that's what it always was. Your codes for goalposts. And remember, someone said the Father Boland could do a goalposts. So he approached the builder, John Hughes, who was building the church, and asked him, could we have some scaffolding poles to make the goalposts? So he provided the scaffolding poles. I know we spent all day Saturday to committee and digging holes. Putting them, cutting the goalposts, tying them together, and put them in place. And we were doing it for our walk. And then we come up the following morning, the goalposts had disappeared. And most of them had an interiorised that people had used them for lion poles. Because coming up from the city, there was all sorts of things as these modern closed doors. Since you wanted to learn Paul, so our goalposts were gone. But fairness to Jim, John Hughes, he provided us with a second set. Now we were probably to force teams to have more of our goalposts, as we used to take them out at night and bring them back over onto the building site for the watchman could look after. But I know when I arrived down in Marion Square, for to enroll the team, I remember it was one of those big Georgian houses that I know was in them. There was a committee sitting on the table and they asked what could they do for myself from Ballyfermot. And I wanted to enroll three teams in the league. And they said, well, all the football, we don't have the football pitches to spare. At the moment, we have enough space for the teams that we have. So I said, well, we have three football pitches in Ballyfermot. And they couldn't believe three pitches. That'd be great, wonderful. We'd be able to use them as well. So we joined the CYC our league. Like we had three teams. It could have been 15, 16, 17, another 15, 16, 17, and maybe another 18. I think there was another 18. But I know shortly after that, one of the meetings in the priest's house. Father Boland said, no, I want you to fire. And then, so my dad said to me, you know the church has been built? So I do. Well, he said, we're looking for a sacristan. I said, what? He said, a sacristan, a cleric. Because I'd never heard the word sacristan. To me, it was the cleric of the church. I said, well, hoping that you would take the job. I said, I just have to think about it. I said, tell your mom and dad about it. See. So I was talking that evening and I said to him, spoken to us, but your call. And I said, I don't know what to do. And he said, look, go up and have a chat with Matt and what's the conditions. So I went up to Father Boland and asked him, what was entailed, what would you need to do, what was the wages. So in addition to telling me I'm talking about, I have to deal with the guards, looking after the altar, looking after the church, open, close, there's ringing bells, there for mass. And I said, I sure don't want to do Latin, I said, we teach it. And the final question was, how much money would I get? And he said, £4 a week. And I said, £4 a week. And at that time, I'm nearly sure I was on either 15 or 16 pounds a week in the ham and leg. I got sending a reduction ticket to myself. Mm-hmm. Now he says there's a possibility. He says, if you cut the collections short in a year for you, particularly at Christmas. And also he says the house may go with the job. And I thought, a house with a job? I contacted where you've got a house. Tipping ahead, my mother has house. Came up at the time, and I said, you're going down in the house. I tried to weigh up the money as against the benefits. However, I decided to go for the job. And when I gave him an address in the Hammond Lane, Harry Jones, the manager, says, what are you leaving? I've told him, and he said, are you sure? I'm still north to leave. And I said, it's an opportunity to have the house and all that. There's no sea of it. Well, you find it there here, he said, I'll get back to increase your wages, £18 a week. And before there was tempting, I opted to go to church and pick up the job in the church. And that was the beginning of that. And eventually, all sorts of incidents occurred that I would have never ever foreseen. And the biggest obstacle was, I was not a church choir, in the sense of, I do with civility and you see your prayers, but it's against me, the Father's church. I tried to come to grips with the procedures in the church, and the reverence that had to have, you couldn't be talking, and everything had to be proper and dealing with it. I found the quiz a game changer for me. And then I was just going back to the football. I thought it was rather ironic that the dressing room we had for the football was in the marching chapel. What was the marching tent? It had changed since. So I thought, well, here I am now with the church, I'm probably used to change and call for that thing. And if we just mentioned that before, because that's the wise club thing. The first clubhouse for Our Lady of Victories Wise Club was in the head house of Father Trice back then. And there was no light in that, and all we had was a hurricane lamp for the light up. And I know Jerry Farnan used to run us around the garden, training as helping me. But anyway, I come from there, back to where we are now. I settled into the job in a way, but I found it getting up to be up there for over for 7 mass, being back for the angels at 12. And Andrew's at 6, the vultures most even, closed at 9, then there was funerals, there was baptisms twice a week, and there would be maybe 10 or 12 children at each baptism. And everything was, you only had a couple of hours to yourself. Now I got 2 half days in the week, which was a Wednesday and a Sunday evening, when my girlfriend and I came, and I went to the pictures. People say to myself, preachers, I said, I know after the first 6 months I'm getting £4 a week, the bonanza hadn't materialised in so far as I've been told you get paid for christenings, you get money for weddings, wakes, and collections, and Christmas. And the church had opened in March, Christmas had come and gone, and there was no mention of our collection. And I mentioned to Father Paul, I know, he said, when we get settled, we look after them. The christenings, I don't say we were poor, but we were allowed to Ballyfermot, but we didn't have much. But the people out there in Ballyfermot had less than we had. And the thoughts of asking them for sixpence for a cell, baptism and certain. So I was thinking, I got the 2 hours. It just wasn't my style. It was open, I was giving out the certs for a bit of nothing. The weddings, they didn't need anything. My first experience of a wedding was that. A funny experience, because I've been told to get paid for the wedding. Got a good few thought. So Father tried the parish priest. He said, you know, it's Sunday morning. Now there's the wedding after Mass. At that time, there wasn't many nuptial weddings in America. What do you call it? Just a ceremony. That you go up to the altar, there was no Mass. You went through the ritual of getting married. And he said, there's a wedding. I said, what do I do? He said, just build four neighbours, two neighbours, and they were through the altar rails. Because at that time, women weren't allowed to get married in the sanctuary. But he said, build three. And he said, get the holy water and a glass tray. So on the joke course, I said, are you right? I said, I'm right. And he said, have you got your bravery? I said, the bravery, was where I would have to respond to his prayers and that. That comes prayers to all SM to settle. But one of my daughter says to me, the bride and groom were kneeling, and he looked at the best man and the bridesmaid, they came over, and he says to the best man, have you got the ring and the silver? So he wrote it in his pocket, and he said, well, Father's ring goes to me, and he said, here, pour it to tray, up it over to the tray, and the best man puts the ring on it, and 2 half-crowns. And I'm looking at the 2 half-crowns, and my God, that's the first one I got for the wedding. I thought, no, well, I laid him on the tray, I'll take them down and put them in my pocket. I said, no, don't let me need them. I laid him on the tray. And so we were the same and progressed. And I saw that the half-crowns was the silver, with this gold and silver, and the red. And I was thinking, holy God, I laid him on the $2 in my pocket. The man said, where's the money gone? I laid him up the creek. That was as near as I got to get paid for the wedding. Wakes, or not wakes, funerals. There was no money to be got of that. At the end of the 6 months, I approached Father Boland. And I said, I found 6 months here. He said, I get a rise at the end of the 6 months. Also, I'll have all for Father's tribe. So I come back to him and come and say, he said, I spoke to Father's tribe. And he said, they get my rose in £2, and that'll be the last one they'll get for the foreseeable future. I said, I'll just get one every 6 months. I will also build a new parish now to the large expenses and everything else. And he says, we'll see how it goes. So I was a bit fall back at that, about £6 a week, wasn't an awful lot. No order at the house, no money from the baptisms. No money coming from anywhere. And I was kind of disillusioned. I suppose the straw that broke the camel's back was that Father Tryon seemed to think that because on the round range of the 12, that we had nothing else to do. So he says to me one day, no, I want you to start digging grounds. So you, what grounds? She said, because the gardens, the church, because the buildings are calm, just everything. And the place was all overgrown with weeds, you know. But I said, I'd be half at 20 o'clock. No, I should have lunch at the ground. He was quite insistent. Now, the ground was full of old brickyard, bricks, all sorts of brick rubble, or builder's rubble. And I said, this is not wrong. I made an attempt to start, and it would have made what we call it a JCB. But when I went over to Father Mom, I said, no, Father, I came here as a sacristan. I didn't come here as a gardener. Came over. He said, what's wrong? So I told him, I said, forget about that. Leave and said, well, you know how to buy something. So I was happy enough with the people went. And then on the morning, it was just for 10 past, Father's friend said 10 past. He had words with me previously, about the Boys Club. He said, are you still playing in the Boys Club? No, I said, I'm over the age, I can't play, I don't know. And but she said, well, oh yes, I'm still on the committee. But he said, I want you to play Gaelic. I said, don't play Gaelic. He said, I want you to play Gaelic. Because the baby come from Kerry. It's back in the world of NGA. And I said, look, Paul, I am not playing Gaelic football. And then he said, I'll close the Boys Club. Well, I said, you may close the Boys Club, but we'll still play football. So I'm definitely not playing Gaelic. So he was quite annoyed that I wasn't prepared to go playing Gaelic. Because most of us were on soccer players. But anyway, some weeks later, he came in to say 10 mass, and I had everything more or less ready, and when he came in, I just opened my glass at the clock. And he says to me, are you joining me? No, sir, I'm not joining you. He said, don't you ever look at the clock when I come in here again. And I said, there's a late conference, I have to get the order ready. And I need to know what time it is. And I said, I'm not joining them, so I have other things to do. So that really pushed me off the edge. So I lowered the Father Boland and I said to him, pick him up. He said, well, I said, it just doesn't suit me. So the hours, the money, don't come nowhere. And he said, that's a pity. I said, oh, are you sure? And I said, yes, I've been thinking about for a quite a while. So I said, well, okay, but so yeah, besides you, I'd see you go. And I said, look, I'm giving you my numbers. So that day I was sleeping down home. And then my father tried to come up the road with his dog. And he waited until he was walking, he was taking him way down. He says, what's it say about you leaving? So I decided to leave. See, it's not over the teeth we had. I'm also not rolling over that. So the other thing, so it's better. So it's primarily, you know, the wages. So I couldn't survive. 6 months a week, and not know when the next come. And when he said, well, at the moment, he says, we're trying to pay off the debt on the church. I said, I understand that. But he said, when I was cutting the cable, he gave me certain insurances. And so I went along with him, gave up a good job. And however, he says, I found myself in the situation now that I'd have to go look for another better paying job. And when he says, if that's what you want to do. So I think it was 6 months later, and I finished his job at Dick Cusick, who had been my assistant there, taking over the job. And I met a father tried, I met him sometime after, and he asked me what I was doing. So I was taking over a job. And he said, what would I'd like to do? Well, I said, I always wanted to be a carpenter. But because my father wasn't a carpenter, I couldn't become a carpenter. But he said, why not? I said, well, there's a thing called the clothes shop. And unless your father's in the trade, but you couldn't use the trade. But shortly after coming to the Ballyfermot, my mother met the man who worked at the Belgian farm. Fearing spent a lot of the houses in Ballyfermot. And I talked to him, she told me, I was over the job. And he said, send me down, why can I fix up as an apprentice carpenter? And I was delighted to talk to him, but I leave him, he won't be sent. Don't bother sending him. He says, the union won't allow it, because his father's not a carpenter. So I said to the father, try to say, you can't get into a trade now, unless your father's in it. But so I would get to there, welding. I said, there's opportunities here. And I said, there's a course coming on in the Halloween, and foundry at the moment. I saw the ad in the paper. And I said, much is it? And I'm not sure whether it was 20 or 30 pounds. And it was a 6 weeks course. But he said, you go down to the loan and we'll pay the cost. And in fairness to the man, he did, he paid for my welding course in the Hamelin. So I come over to Hamelin 6 weeks later. And we said, qualified welder. I said, yeah, it's a bench book. And with no practical experience, so I was like, not sent. And I started calling out jobs, looking for a job as a welder. And again, I ran into the problem of union, a union. no, you can't start here. So, my grandfather was Coghlan. There was the other church here at the time. And he asked me, I said, what? I said, I was born. And he said, if I hear that, I'm not going to give a shout. But to my surprise, he was down the front of the evening to say I was to go up to Rollstone on the middle of that and ask for Mr. Courtney. So I do cross and up there. Oh, yes, Mr. Courtney. To Mr. Courtney. He said, I heard about you. And he says, what can you do? I said, well, I said, can you do anything? That's going to do plating and fabricating and what he was talking about. But materialised that he was talking about metal fabrication. I said, no, I can't do it. No. But I said, it wouldn't have been for a welder only. I said, yeah, you're like a goodness, a helper. So he said, yeah, okay, we take you out as a helper. So we did the last one as a helper. And between the helper and the last one, they were kind of bit on the scales at the time. And my daughter spent 20 years in there, so. And a metal fabricator, Moses, who was out in the quarries. So we were maybe done that then. And my boy had in the meantime, I got married. Nearly forgetting that. Not that that was very important. But I got married when I was 25. And when we maybe done that, also, we had two children who were living down in a place called the Tenders, just off Newmarket, off the coal mine. And again, I was onto the road, Norton Farm. Oh, where does one get the job? Because at that time there was quite a recession on. And I ended up working in for the Coghlan Ever Place, and I had all of my window friends.
Yeah.
And I worked with them for about 3 years. And again, was never redundant. So I was on the door again, and my wife Kay came in one evening and said she was having a meeting of what I know what I need to do. And she said, she asked about me. What was I doing? I said, I was doing. She said, nothing. So I woke up. And she says, well, send them up to Thomas Cross Centre. The local cemetery, do a wood walk, a metal walk. Because there's always came with wood walk, I was a mixture of them, but from bent and wardrobes, kitchen porch, and all that sort of thing. So I could say I'm fairly handy with that wood walk. So they said, I'm going to talk about wood walk, a metal walk. So I was somewhat cynical about the job and I'm done. I said, I don't particularly care to go up because I've got so many disappointments. Well, she said, I can't. We don't know the guy said he did, but I've just gone. Anyway, just a place I looked at Thomas Cross Centre, which was just off Main Street. And I met the manager. Oh yeah, he said, Sister Brenda was telling me that there was someone coming. So we had a chat. He said, not a shop. So he brought me around the workshop and I could see all sorts of activity going on. None of them have a sense to me because nobody seemed to know what I was doing. Because so people welded them in the middle of the floor, which was a very safe place. And there was all sorts of things going on. And then he said, when can you start? I said, start? Yeah, yeah. He said, do we have a job here for you? Well, my exercise on with somebody else. Mm-hmm. So I couldn't believe maybe he's offering a job. I said, God, so I start now. He said, you can start tomorrow. No, so I start now. Think of myself, because I've only got home now, someone else might get my job. But anyway, he said, oh, it's only a temporary job. So I said, I'll take it. So the temporary job lasted 15 years. And within, when I was 50, I came out when I was 65. And it turned out that the job was walking people with disabilities. A lot of work with suffering from hairs, schizophrenic, manic depressives. But I was absolutely one of the place to walk. I walk with people. And my job was not so much to teach them to welding, but to do woodwork. as to gain sort of confidence.
Yeah.
Which goes into the war plan, making priorities. And I would have loved to have stayed on in the job, but the ruling was a hitch. It was one way to help, a decent help at the time. And the rule there was that you go at 65. So at 65 I was told, packing bags, I go.
Okay.
So that was what I went. And reluctantly, I didn't want to leave the job, because I lived about 4 kilometres, just about at least. I used to meet some of them from time to time. And I'm glad to say some of them have done well. Others are still the same as I left the side of the same. But that's where we are.
And just bring you back to Ballyfermot, just for in the early days. You mentioned that you used to do your shopping in Inchicore, and you went to the pictures in Inchicore, I take it?
Yeah, the only job which I was.
What shops was available in Ballyfermot then?
There was only one shop. It's called Plowman on Ballyhammer Road. It would be near where there was a garage. The garage has since closed. But that was the only shop that was with that I can remember.
Yeah, that's the only shop, yeah. And further up the scheme, there was nothing, there was only fields.
Because the scheme was only up to Coymore Road. We're building Lambert Road. My father told me, he worked in the estate, that the first house was built in Ballyfermot was on the top of Lambert Road, and they started walking down towards the ranch.
Oh,
that was the way they walked down.
Yeah.
And there was no houses beyond what was become Coghlan Road. It was all open fields.
Yeah.
And there was nothing there at all. Well, we played the football. That was became the site for the Dominican Convent. And prior to playing the football there, we used to play further down, which was the site for the De La Salle schools.
Yeah.
And I know we used to go to these De La Salle schools in the evening, and some evenings they had bingo sessions and things there.
And the three pitches that the CYC was delighted with, that was where the Dominican Convent is now.
No, that's where that is now.
That's where you played your football.
Because I always kids when we came to Ballyfermot first, we played football where Deesey's Road. Where Deesey's Road now is, and we're in opposite what is Markovic's Park.
Yeah.
Because all that side was much greener, grassy, level. And I know we used to always try to go home. My teacher called Walsh Harding Blow.
Yeah.
It was like 4:15. And we tried to go home, see if it was any shape. But then that was about some talk of it.
And Markovic Park, was that farm at that time? Or was it? No. Was it? No, it wasn't. The farm was gone.
The farm had gone. There was it? I know the Presbytery. And by the way, church, I think it was it Maryman, was the name?
Maryman, that's right.
And where it's been the farm. Because I remember Father tried telling me that my father on the Scallon, he came up from Inchicore Parish. He was the first curate. And then Father Boland came. And then later on, Father Troy was appointed as parish priest. He came from Hartley's Cross. But another father Scanlon telling me that when he approached the corporation for a house, and he mentioned about the old farmhouse that was there, that there was no name, and they wanted to build a church there. Could he have it? The council wanted to sell it to them. He said, I'm not buying it, you should lock it down. I'm not buying the house from it. And they said, okay, take it. So that became the presbytery. But he was there. Well, my hand could make a deal.
Yeah.
So he ended up in later on he went to Wales, partly to look after Irish workers in Wales. And Father Ball went to London to look after the Irish workers in London. They had chaplains.
Yeah.
But I think it was Maryman. Maryman owned the land up around there. I know there was a farm at the top of Valley Road. I can't think of the name of the farm.
Yeah.
So that was the same when
And your parents stayed on then they in the, on Lally Road.
Lally Road, yeah. My father, he died, he was 78. My mother, she was 96 when she died. And my sister's living in the house. So we visited her quite often.
Yeah, I'd say, yeah.
Just keep in touch.
So down the years you have seen a lot of changes here in Ballyfermot?
Sure, huge changes. Now I come up, now I'm sticking to your hair now. I noticed that it was called the glass roll, but I didn't realize the changes that take place.
Yeah.
This is the first time I've ever been up here in the library. And I must say it's been a fabulous place and wonderful asset to the community. And I've been looking around at the houses at the evening, you know, what's getting there, and the departments have taken place up there at the city council, but there's some great progress made in Ballyfermot. I know there used to be a joke about it in the early days of Ballyfermot. They referred to it as Ballyfermot. And they used to, I remember we had a show in the Lyle, and the comedian cracked a joke saying that the people in Ballyfermot played for about 2 weeks on the trot. The people up there know where they got the money. So the implication was saying that they just didn't have the money. But the changes have taken place in over the years, absolutely wonderful. I know there's some sad things down so far, I believe, that some of the schools are closing. The deal is out, that's not about closing that, which all doesn't happen. But I can't remember, there was some kind of progress. I hope it doesn't happen.
Well, that's great, no, delighted with the little bit of history there, you know. And just one last thing, on the 15th of March 1953, you were the very first sacrament in the church for that Mass.
For that Mass, Father Flynn, so he was a parish priest, Bishop McQuaid, he was the Bishop of Dublin, he done the opening ceremony. Now, when the church was opened, there was only about half the seats in it. The toys were not on the floor. There was I spent it the week prior to the church opening. It was like walking for a builder, clearing blocks, rubbing and everything. And I would say, well, possibly a year after the church opened, they were finally finished. Because the sacristy wasn't finished, the vestment presses weren't in, the painting wasn't done, even the parkway flooring wasn't done at that time. That was on the altar. They put down carpets around the front for the open. Because Father tried to help me put the pressure on. She was the builder, and he had declared an opening date. And the opening date, he had given them, it was coming up to Patrick's Day, and also Lent was commencing at that time. And that was another eye-opener for me, what you do during Lent. All I knew during Lent, fortunately, was you didn't need meat on a Wednesday or a Friday. Not that you ever had meat on a Friday. But I know for the Holy Week service, I'm sorry to have you there at 6 in the morning. The service starts at 6. And they went on. And I know I'm forced trying to be initiated into what I had to do. And they told me it would Easter Sunday and the Paschal fire. And the pastor put up in the porch, and they said, "I'll make sure Father Boland had taken paint. It was telling me, you put the charcoal into the fire is lit, and then the charcoal is taken from the fire, spread into the toilet, and the incense is put in, and the ceremony come in, back up the church then, and this was the beginning of Easter. This will be Easter Sunday morning, and then." I remember standing in the sacristy on the Saturday night. What time was it? I can't remember exactly what it was. It was late on a Saturday night. And I think it was midnight Mass. It was. And they said, I have the four night. A light comes. I got a 5 gallon drum. And the whole thing. That's my hammer day experience being a leper. right before. So, bearing in mind the length of the distance and the length of the church, I went out the side, raced around to the front of the church, lit the fire, run out of the way, took up my place at the head of the procession. I was carrying the crucifix down to church, and Father Chai and all the priests praying down behind me, all the Jewish ceremony. And as I was walking down, I could see my name before the church, the flames rising and rising. I called up, I said, oh God, I don't, can I go to the porch? The flames were hitting the ceiling. Father Chai said, look at this inferno. And Father looked at me, he says, we have to get the charcoal out of the fire. I looked around. Look, we have two pieces of steel. So I had to reach into the fire, get the charcoal, drop it into the tube, put Father Chai there. And as if nothing was wrong, to parade back up to church, in sense of the congregation. I know the following morning when I went down to inspect the damage, I said, definitely the porch needs repainting. I said, luckily it was a concrete ceiling. But I said, if it wouldn't save, it would have gone on fire.
So you nearly burnt the church down, did you?
Maybe some parts of
the church. Oh, yeah.
Candle went. I took the take on the trot, so to speak. I know the names of some of the lads who played football and get those to you.
Oh, we can record all them, yeah. No, that'd be good because mainly, you know, the families love to sit down and
then,
you
know. I went to some of the lads.
Oh, there is a good few of them still around. Yeah, there's a good few of the families still around. And they'd love to hear that, you know. Thanks very much. Yeah. I'll record all them.
That was the committee. Probably some of the lads have played on the other teams.
Brilliant.
And most of them from Levy Road. There's two of them from Levy Road.
Yeah, brilliant. Yeah.
Are you from here around the area, Sean?
Coghlan,
are you?
Oh, yeah.
There was a painter who worked for John, who's the builder. He lived on Coghlan Road. Now, I don't remember his name. Billy, what? God knows. Have a clue where his second name was. He was doing the finishing touches on the church. Now he's on the after church
hall. Yeah.
And I said to him, that's a person on Coyle Wall.
Yeah.
Just on the left hand side, going down, but the completion to the other side.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yes. And listen, thanks for those memories. As I say, we record those memories and we'll make sure you get CD.
Thank you. God,
terrific.
No, I suppose there's lots of other
things. Oh, no, we picked up quite a lot there from the I should have brought you in some water. You're okay, are you? Yeah. Something that
I think we were over here. Oh, we got the electricity in the gas.
Yeah.
And you couldn't paint the house through wallpaper. Had to let it dry out.
It did dry out, yeah.
At the plaster.
When you moved here at the start from the tenements, what how many rooms would have been in your tenement at the time?
There was only one room.
One room.
Candle Street. There was two rooms, if you call it. And the eight was over there.
Eight.
And then we brought the grandmother's deliveries. And that was nothing. I don't know that. I think about the mother of the world, and everyone wants a bedroom for my kids there.
That's right, yeah.
And say, help me grow up.
And then in Lally Road, was there two or three bedrooms?
Three bed. And that's what my father's mentioned. Because I used to follow the Noel football club, and up every Sunday to see them playing. They played in Chapelizer, behind the church.
Yeah.
And he said to me, make sure you're up to Ballyfermot. Get the numbers of all the houses down on that road and get the semi-detached house on the semi-detached house. And I said, make sure that the three bedroom house. So I remember coming up from Chapel Lizard, finding my way out on Lally Road. Because he'd be down to the corporation and they had said to him, I'm ridiculous. I said, you sure now? So definitely, they're all the same attached. So actually, he wanted 156 for some reason, but that was gone. And he got 158, that's what we are.
158.
And like I said, he was in the ESP, and there was only one socket in the house, and was built one socket. So before we did, because the competition come out to inspect the house to fix doors and windows and things, and he had broken another plumber. And they told him to get the orders. He said, why did they get the orders? He said, that's only one. He said, we could have it stay in there.
Yeah, yeah.
I said, they haven't put it in.
I know what
but
you mean.
But it was only one because the only thing you'd have to try would be a radio or an arm.
Yeah.
There was no other.
Well, even to this day, I'm funny, I've heard it from a few people that has got houses, even here in Ballyfermot, up on Colmore Road especially, and the girl was telling me, I knew the family that moved over there, you know, the mother died and the house was given back to the corporation, and the house would have been in great nick, they would have had the windows and, you know, they would have had it all up to date, because the son was a carpenter, and they got the corporation come in and took everything out. And they put it, no, I'm not saying their stuff was probably just as good, you know, but they took everything out of there, all scrap.
Yeah.
And it was the best of stuff they took out, you know,
so,
and that's the way that seemed to be their policy down the years, right from the war goal.
I see on the level over there some months ago, Mrs. Atomic. You went from the house, come in, clear down there.
Yeah.
I wonder if there's no one.
Well, as I say, I'll be in touch with you, but in the meantime, you won't forget the 27th, yourself and Kay.
27th, yeah.
Well, it'd be nice to have you up here.
Yeah.
Whatever time you want to stroll in,
yeah.
And you can stroll out,
yeah.
You know, there's no, it'll be during that day, you know, we'll be here, and there'll be lots of old photographs.
What day is it?
It'll be Saturday morning, same time,
yeah.
You know, from
this day 3 weeks, isn't it?
This day 3 weeks, yeah, that's right, yeah.
And we're going for.
Oh, it's going on for today, you know what I mean, yeah, today, and we're going to leave the old photographs up.
I know Kay, she's our second one, we'll tell
you. Whatever she wants to do, you know.
Maybe me see if
that'll
work.
Yeah, no, you know, like it goes into me.
I just read a shop.
Well, I have a mate, Bruce, and he comes in from Ashbourne, and you know, he's a Protestant, but he meets up with a lad that's a Catholic, and they go into the church for Mass. And then they do their shopping and every Saturday morning.
That's it, on Main Street.
Yeah, in Main Street, yeah. Goes in, he loves it with the dealers and all that, you know what I mean? And he loves the bargain, you know.
Yeah.
You keep haggling for the bargain, you know. Yeah.
There's a big grill on there at the moment. Oh, usually the bull ring. The one with the casino.
Yeah.
Oh.
And the paper saying, no, wait, there is a little casino that
won't
get.
That's what they want.
They don't want. Was with the problems in the area, drugs, drink, and gambling and everything else.
Yeah.
So I don't know how to go with that.
Yeah.
Plan by mission, but people are not happy with it at all. They're looking as it is. I know it's a bit of a mess at times with the dealers and all, but it's part of the character of that.
I was down in Noel's house there, in the, and it's a beautiful house there. Beautiful garden, actually. Congratulated you on the day, the garden, you had the garden.
The green white garden's garden.
Yeah, a lovely garden, yeah.
We made sure about the Tenters.
Tenters.
It's just off Cork Street. And the name, it gave voice to a name that's in the dictionary, Temper Hooks. If you're on Temper Hooks.
Yeah.
Because Gold Magazine, when the Huguenots came to Ireland, they went to the poplin, making material, poplin and linen. And when they used to make it, they needed to stretch it out to let it dry. And in these fields, they used to stretch them on hooks.
Uh-huh.
And fields were known as the Tenter Fields. And then with the hooks on it again, the Tenter Hook. And with the tension on the things, on the, to stop the linen from shrinking.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So the word Tenter Hook came into being because you got a bit stretched. The tension.
Yeah, yeah.
And that was, apparently gave rise to that word Tenter. Tempers Fields. No, we don't know which were known as Tempers Fields.
Yeah.
Prior to that. Because there were the Tempers Fields, there were fair religious fields, and then they became what they are today.
Yeah. And that was your wife's family was in that house?
No,
no. Oh, no, 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 that was
she lived in Pimlico. So, like, some of my grandmothers lived down that area, and they always had a bit of a graph in that area, so they had a good house like that.
Well, listen, thanks very much for those memories there. Terrific memories. And can I also talk, thanks, Sean, for doing the video here as well, you know?